I think we've just had a few more join us, which is awesome and amazing. We'll get started here. I just want to say hello and welcome and thank you for joining us today. We are so grateful and thankful that you took the time out. I'm Marty Hartman. I'm the director of Mary's Place. And I just want to say thank you for joining us for our fourth Lunch and Learn. You can find the recordings of our past Lunch and Learns on our website. And Katrina will put that link in chat for us. But we've had some amazing topics and we are excited about today's topic. We know that Washington's eviction moratorium ended on November 1st and thousands of families in our state who are behind in their rent due to the economic impacts of COVID are really facing the possibility of falling into homelessness. Due to the impacts of systemic racism, our Black, Indigenous, and families of color have been disproportionately impacted by this crisis. And we have seen a significant rise in the number of families affected by domestic violence. So today at our Lunch and Learn, we'll talk about the work the community providers are doing to help keep families in their homes now that the eviction moratorium has expired, how we are working together alongside landlords to distribute the current government funding and really take full advantage of those programs to keep families housed. But we know that the current funding is temporary. Right? It's a temporary solution to a long-term problem, and it will not be enough. We'll talk about why additional private funding is needed to sustain these programs going forward. So I hope that you'll find some new information today. At today's Lunch and Learn, I just want to start. Before I introduce our panelists, I'd like to begin our time together by acknowledging the land on which Mary's Place operates. It's the traditional home of the Coast Salish people, specifically the home of the Duwamish, Snohomish, and Suquamish, who are, although not all recognized by the federal government, are still here today. I offer gratitude to elders and all other Coast Salish peoples, past, present, and future, who have made it possible for each of us to live, work, play, and love in this community. And I want to invite each of us to seek authentic relationships with Indigenous communities, to continue to learn about the past and present colonial impacts, and to move beyond acknowledgement to action. And today is one of those steps you're taking to act, so thank you. I just want to give a little background about Mary's Place for those of you who may be new to us. Mary's Place began more than 20 years ago as a day center for women experiencing homelessness right here in downtown Seattle. Our drop-in women's day center is still here. It is the heart of Mary's Place. We're located at 9th and Stewart, where we serve about 100 women a day. And we provide basic necessities. You know, women can come in and get showers and laundry and dry, warm clothing, along with two meals and resources for housing and employment and wellness. And we were always open to serving children at our day center when we started. But in that first decade from 1999 to 2009, we rarely saw a child come through our doors. There was enough shelter capacity. But during the recession, we started seeing moms with children coming through our doors at a rapid rate. We had no resources to offer. There was no shelter capacity. There was no funding. And we didn't have the expertise in running overnight shelter, but we knew we had to do something. We could not be bystanders and watch children sleep outside. So we opened our first overnight shelter for women and children in 2011, and we have continued to develop our programming really to address the growing need outside. Not long after that first shelter opened, we knew we needed to keep families together to address their housing needs together. And so we opened a shelter to include families with moms and dads, and then single dads. And then we extended our shelter capacity for multi-generational families, families with pets, families who had lost everything caring for a sick child. And that started the beginning of our Popsicle Place program. And before COVID, we provided emergency shelter and meals together with resources for housing and employment and healthcare and wellness for 800 moms and dads. Mary's Place runs the King County Shelter Intake Line. Every day, every night, we take those calls. And before this pandemic, we were so close to reaching that goal of No Child Sleeps Outside. We were offering shelter to every family that called every day. But last spring, we had to close 4 smaller shelters to keep guests and staff safe. So we currently have 500 beds in 5 shelters across King County, a loss of 300 beds. And these beds, all of those 500 beds are at capacity every night. We are working hard to add back that capacity as we prepare for families that will face homelessness due to this eviction moratorium being lifted. And for those who can't come into shelter, our mobile outreach teams are out there every day connecting families to resources and flexible funding from our Rapid Response Fund to address barriers and move them quickly back into housing. We've discussed some of those issues and programs in our past Lunch and Learns, and we invite you to watch those webinars that are available on our website to learn more. But we all know the safest place for a family to be is in their own home. And today we will focus on those programs and the partnerships that are doing that great work to keep families in their home in our community. So that leads us to the panel that we have for today, our amazing panel. I want to introduce first Dominique Alex. Dominique is Mary's Place Chief Program Officer. Hi, Dominique. And she oversees all of our shelter and program services for families experiencing homelessness in our communities, which includes a lot of programs, our youth services, our healthcare services, our outreach, and our housing support programs. So thank you, Dominique. Next, I want to introduce Miriam Clithero. Miriam is one of Mary's Place amazing staff members. Mary's Place leads our prevention and stability program. She is the director. She oversees the prevention program that connects families with the resources and with the funding needed really to keep them in their homes. And she provides services to help them remain stable in their housing. So welcome, Miriam. So glad you're here. And we have a special guest today. Chelsea Stevenson is the Southeast Network Safetynet resource and intake director of the Boys and Girls Club, who works alongside Annie, the operation director of the Boys Club. And we're sorry Annie couldn't be here today. She's sick, but we are grateful that Chelsea is here to represent the great work they're doing together. But the Boys and Girls Club is really leading the initiative to connect families to rental assistance funding as our community recovers from the impact of COVID-19 as they partner with Mary's Place through the Boys and Girls of Tukwila Club. So thank you, Chelsea, for being here. And our amazing long-term partner, Alison Dean, the president of HNN Communities, is an affordable housing provider. Did you know that HNN provides over 10,000 apartments just in King County and over 20,000 apartments in the state of Washington? They have been an amazing partner in helping our kids find housing, helping our families find housing, and in working with their tenants to prevent homelessness. So I just want to say right up front, this, what a gift it is to have all of you here at the same place today talking about this. So thank you, thank you, thank you. We're going to jump right in, and I'm going to start with Miriam. How about that? Is that all right, Miriam? Your work at Mary's Place really focuses on the prevention and stability work needed to keep our women and families in their homes. Can you talk about what you're seeing? Maybe talk about the current need and what programs are available to support those who need the support?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Marty. Thanks for having me, and welcome everybody. My name is Miriam and I use she, her pronouns. I have had the great honor of working at Mary's Place for over 5 years and have worn a number of different hats, and I'm now pivoted to support this body of work at Mary's Place, the eviction prevention and housing stability services. You know, we've known for some time how important this work can be in reducing the trauma of women and families, but this is especially important during this critical time where, you know, most of the moratoria and bridges have expired and thousands of households are at risk of losing their homes. We learned during a pilot at the beginning of the year how important it was for Mary's Place to stand in the gap, and we're absolutely thrilled to be gifted private dollars to support households who were unable to be served through the county program, and those who had fallen through the cracks and needed some additional rental assistance to maintain their homes. To get those households caught up and their back rent paid, we really saw that eviction prevention and rental assistance is incredibly cost effective. And on average, we issued just over $2,300 per household. Additionally, this year, seven households have been gifted long-term rental assistance from 3 to 12 months of support that has deeply impacted these families to becoming housing stable, increase income, and really care for their families' well-being. One of these families, a 25-year-old single mom with a chronic health condition and two kiddos, has actually been able to boost her income with a higher paying job and actually was able to relocate from a one bedroom to a two bedroom apartment where she's able to give her tween their own room for the first time. These are the kinds of stories and examples that we've really seen this great shift in awareness around the incredible need and impact eviction prevention and rental assistance can have on helping people stay in their homes. We are thrilled to have been awarded over a $2 million contract with King County and are so excited to get to work with amazing partners like Chelsea and Annie at Boys and Girls Club, Community Passageways, and the East Side Legal Assistance Program, or ELAP, they're also known by. And we're all working together to distribute federal prevention and rental assistance to our neighbors. We've really only been up and running since the beginning of October and have already pushed out more than $1.4 million to 123 households. The average household has received about $11,000 of assistance, but this is stretched over a 12-month period of time typically. So we're able to support with 9 months of back rent and then 3 months of future rent, which is huge. The King County Eviction Prevention and Rental Assistance Program, that's the name that you may have heard of in the news. It's called EPRAP, we use that term. And just wanted to share, there's like three pathways related for folks to get help. One is through the landlord program, which Alison will talk about a little bit, where larger properties are actually enrolling their tenants who have gotten behind in rent so they can get help. The second route is through the tenant pool that has been open since May, and households can register through the King County website and may get served through a lottery process that happens weekly. And then there's the hub and spoke model that Mary's Place is participating in. The vision of this model was to really have agencies like Mary's Place partner with buy-in for community-based organizations that have leadership and staff of color, language and cultural diversity, and who have direct ties and relationships to their clients and to people who may not have awareness or access to eviction prevention and rental assistance. We have seen with these partnerships that households are getting connected to these critical dollars who are not in the system and who have, who they have not applied for help and whose landlords are not participating in the landlord program. And if we didn't have these partnerships, these are families and households who would have fallen through the cracks if we had not been able to build this team of incredible organizations to collaborate with together. I do want to share that, what we are seeing from people is that they are deeply afraid. We are getting daily calls from tenants who are desperate to remain housed, particularly families who we've served in the past at Mary's Place. Through shelter and outreach. And they're saying, like, I cannot be homeless again. Please, can you help me? I'm so scared. I can't put my babies through this again. And it is heart-wrenching. And our teams are navigating these pleas with grace, compassion, and information. I think what we really didn't realize and anticipate was that not only are we serving households with rental assistance, we are actually filling a stated need from families and landlords by providing information and navigation of these complex systems. And this experience has really demonstrated to us how important it is for Mary's Place to continue to leverage both public and private dollars so that we can continue to have flexibility to support families and women and households who may not, may have received assistance already in the last year and are no longer eligible for this next round of funding. or for people who were deemed ineligible for the EPRAP program because of, you know, maybe language, maybe they didn't answer the door, maybe there's cultural issues or trauma responses that have caused people to not get connected. So we really want to be able to share more stories of housing stability, like a family we served 2 weeks ago who had gotten behind on rent just a bit because of COVID restrictions in their job, but then they had two deaths in their family in the same month and ended up getting further behind because of funeral costs. When our specialist called the mom to enroll her, she had started receiving repayment plan notices from the property and was really afraid of being evicted. When we got her application submitted and told her about the 3 months of future rent, she started to cry because she felt so relieved and thankful. And, you know, and we're all thankful for you, and thank you for listening. So I'm going to pass it back to you, Marty.
Thank you, Miriam. The work you and your team does is really life-giving, and I'm just so grateful for each of you and for the way that you build community, right? And bring us all together to solve this crisis. So thank you so much for all that you do. If you have questions for Miriam, please put those or type those into the Q&A tab. And now I have the pleasure of, I'm gonna pick out Chelsea. So Chelsea, we're so grateful for you and the work that the Boys and Girls Club does for the community. And we're excited about our new partnership, really, that has been made possible by these EPRAP dollars to provide rental assistance funding together with the Boys and Girls Club. Can you introduce yourself and then maybe talk a little bit about the Boys and Girls Club, talk about your work within the hub and spoke model that Miriam described, and then maybe, what you're seeing for families who are applying to receive those funds? Who's eligible? Do you think that there are others falling through the cracks? Maybe those type of things. Take it away, Chelsea. Thank you again.
Thanks, Marty. I'm really excited to join you all here today. Like Marty said, I'm Chelsea Stevenson. I work for the Southeast Network Safetynet program, which is a program that specializes in violence prevention and intervention, as well as community safety. We're part of the Boys and Girls Clubs of King County. And I work really closely with Annie Falatogo, who is our operations director for some of our South King County clubs. Between her and myself and our counterpart, Erin, we're able to provide outreach to all of our clubs. We have over 30 clubs throughout King County, from North Seattle to Federal Way, all the way out to Sammamish. So we're able to serve a really broad broad service area. And one thing that's really important to us is serving those who need us the most. And that goes from just the club aspect, providing, you know, childcare or after school care, but also in additional services that we provide. I think a lot of folks think of the Boys and Girls Club as childcare or as an after school program, but it's been really important to us to make sure that we're providing services to our families that meet all of their needs holistically. We recognize that, you know, a lot of our families don't have a place to go home to at night, or maybe facing homelessness potentially, are without meals. So when we had the opportunity to partner with Mary's Place, we were extremely excited. In addition to the work that we do in the clubs, we are also based in the community. So we have deep partnerships with a lot of the schools, including case managers that work at Rainier Beach High School. So we were really excited, these past couple of months to be able to start reaching out to the families that we're already connected with and informing them of this incredible resource. Due to institutionalized racism, our participants experienced a disproportionate amount of trauma due to gun violence. And what we're seeing is, just from a trauma-informed approach, is that the eviction moratorium coming to an end is just kind of like re-triggering some of those traumas that they're experiencing. So it's just been really great to be able to partner with Mary's Place in making sure that those who may have been like slipping through the cracks and may not have known about these funds are really getting the services that they need to stay in their homes. I think something that Miriam touched on a little bit and we're definitely seeing is that a lot of these families just want to be heard. So a lot of the folks that are falling through the cracks, maybe just they've been reaching out to a bunch of different providers trying to get help and are feeling desperate. They're scared that they're going to be evicted, not have a place to go, and are trying to care for their families. So just really even being able to take the time to, you know, listen to them and what they're going through and help them navigate through this process has been significant. And I'll pass it back to you, Marty.
You and the Boys and Girls Club are awesome and amazing. The way that you impact our communities all through King County is just really a huge gift. And we are so grateful. So thank you for really championing and advocating for families in every area and every arena. We are so grateful to have you partnering and championing rental assistance and really getting the dollars out there to keep families in their homes. So awesome and amazing. If you out there have questions for Chelsea, please use that Q&A button down at the bottom of your screen. And we want to make sure we'll answer those right after we finish our presentation. So guess who's next? So we were going to talk to Alison. So Alison, we've been so fortunate to partner with HNN Communities as a landlord who makes it possible for so many of our families to find affordable housing. We are so grateful for you. Can you talk about how you partner with community providers like Mary's Place to provide rental assistance in the current programs? And really, how have you seen rental assistant needs change with the impacts of COVID? We would love to know more about that.
Absolutely. Thanks for inviting me into this conversation space today and welcome everyone. We're so glad that you are joining us for this really critical conversation. I think we started our partnership with Mary's Place maybe back in 2018. Marty, you might be able to date check me on that. Over that period of time and really recognizing our need to participate as a large affordable housing provider in this crisis that we're experiencing and the importance of participating in that as an organization to try and find stable homes for people to be in. We've housed hundreds of households. So it's probably in the thousands of people at this point, which is incredibly exciting. But as Miriam and I also often talk about, it's not just getting people into housing, as we know, it's maintaining stability in that housing too. So we work really hard on the front end of placement, obviously with our families, but many of the households are obviously AMI, the area median income is very high here and not surprising to everyone. I think that people are often one paycheck or less than one paycheck away from being unstable and that continues. And especially people entering back into housing from homelessness, maybe trying to find stable jobs and other things too. So the pandemic really not only disproportionately affects people in affordable housing for many of the reasons that people have already discussed here, systemic issues and beyond. But in particular, the homeless population, of course, who is maybe even less stable than people who have been in that housing for a period of time. And for us as housing providers, there's nothing that we want more than to have stable residents and stable communities. And so the funding that we have been working to administer with Mary's Place and the county and other partners during the pandemic has been so critical for these households. And we work in a number of different channels, as Miriam communicated. earlier today. As a large landlord and a large affordable landlord, we decided to enter into a large landlord contract with the county because we have thousands of households that are at need and that we want to be able to make sure that we're trying to administer that funding as efficiently and as quickly as possible for people too. There's so many emotions that come up for people. There's trauma, obviously, lived experiences here. And as landlords, we don't want people feeling that way either, worrying about being evicted for non-payment, especially during these really difficult times. So the way that the county funding works, that you can enter into or enter a resident into that pool if they're up to 50% of the area median income. AMI is the abbreviation for that. And many of our residents fall outside of that window too. So we have people up to 80% AMI living in our affordable communities. And because of the high level of income, AMI here in the region, there is a pretty large population of people that fall between that 50 to 80% bracket that are also in critical need and help too. So we've partnered with Mary's Place in particular. Their clients that have come to live in HNN homes and communities to make sure that we're having them apply through these other channels and or accessing other private funding sources, however possible, so that the bandwidth of residents in that bracket are able to maintain stability too. And that has been huge. We've had pop-ups, we've had caseworkers at our communities, inviting them in because we know as a landlord, it might be frightening or scary to have a conversation with us. So we try to create channels of communication and welcome people into our community to be there to meet residents who may have transportation issues or other issues. Trying to get to places to access funding, technological issues, there's all kinds of barriers. And that has been an incredible experience. So we're really grateful for Mary's Place and the county because the more channels that we have for people, the better off everyone's going to be in the long run. And I don't think that the pandemic funding administration is going to be ending anytime soon because the need is so great too. And there was a need prior for rent relief funding before the pandemic too. And so I hope we're also learning some things and creating some partnerships that will remain long-term in terms of being able to provide rent relief and funding support for residents.
Wow. Thank you, Alison. HNN is such an incredible partner. We could not do this work without you and your willingness to collaborate and really make it possible to provide so many options for your tenants, our former guests. We all know the need for rent relief and to keeping families in their homes. So thank you for all you're doing for championing families everywhere you go. And we are just so incredibly grateful for HNN. And I think there's some questions coming in, but we'll save those for the end. But if you have additional questions for Alison, please use the Q&A chat at the bottom of the screen. Put those questions right in there. We want to get to all of them, and we will do that. And let's see, we have our final panelist today is our amazing Dominique. And Dominique, in your role, you really help address the need for families entering shelter and really overcoming the barriers to move forward into housing. Can you talk about where you see that need to go as a community to achieve No Child Sleeps Outside? Is it possible? Is it doable?
Thanks, Marty. I absolutely do think that it's possible. I think as a community, if we come together, anything's possible. One of the things we know is that while emergency shelter is a need And we're able to fulfill that on most nights for the families that call into our intake line. We know that we need to move upstream. And I think you've heard colleagues on this call really talk about a way forward. And I think the way forward is really thinking about the preventative work and keeping families in their hard-won homes, right? We don't want folks to be on the streets or trying to figure out how they're going to keep their children warm and safe. And so one of the ways that I really believe we need to continue to do this work is thinking about what's our way forward and having sustainable funding so that no child does sleep outside. The funding that we currently have is COVID related. So we are very grateful for that. As we see, the moratorium has been devastating. Folks are experiencing eviction and crisis around stability in their housing for the first time. Some people have nowhere to turn. And so this idea that we've had families calling in and being able to access this funding has allowed them to stay in their homes. Miriam talked about the over 100 families that we've been able to serve during this short period of time. And the average was about $11,000. We know that for bringing someone into shelter costs about $16,000 for the 90 days. But the average is about $11,000 to cover rental assistance right now. We're going to be way more cost effective and reduce trauma with our families and coming into shelter. And so this is our way upstream and having no child sleep outside. Some of the other things that I think are really important is the 3 months forward that Miriam talked about that we're able to support families in, it helps stabilize. And one of the programs that we are also doing is some stability work. And I do believe that those relationships that we have with our families that are in those experiences in their crisis, when they have relationships that help build those provider relationships so they know who to turn to before they hit the crisis is also really important and they sustain in that 90-day period that really allows for them to breathe, to find the things that help stabilize their family and moving forward. And so no child has to sleep outside. So I do really believe that this is more cost effective as we move upstream to do the prevention work together. And we know that this CARES funding will maybe see some in 2022, but after that, that is not a sustainable funding source. And so we really need to come together to find those sustainable dollars that we can continue to do this work because we know it works, we know it's cost effective, and we also know that we can achieve No Child Sleeps Outside together as this path forward.
I love that. Dreaming big, we know it's possible, we know it's doable, but it will take all of us. And Dominique and her teams do amazing work in this community, and we are so grateful that you are continuing to advocate to push for what is right in keeping families in their homes. Wow. Thank you, Dominique, for all of that. If you have questions for Dominique, just like the rest, put them in that Q&A tab down at the bottom. And I just want to say thank you to the entire panel. We are so blessed by having you here today. And now here comes the great part. We get to answer the audience questions. So I'm going to turn it over to Katrina. Thank you, Katrina, for being with us. Can you read the questions that have come in so far? And we'll just direct them to the right panelists. And if you ask these questions and we haven't answered it, please let us know. You can put that right back in chat if you want, or the Q&A button to let us know.
Got some great questions coming in. First one, I think Miriam might be able to speak to this. How does someone get an eviction off their record that occurred due to COVID?
Thanks, Katrina. It's going to be a bit tricky. I don't know if there is one straightforward answer to that. But what I would say is that if someone has received an eviction during COVID, it will be really important to access legal aid and legal services. The first, there's a few different pathways in King County. One of them is actually our partnership with ELAP. So the Eastside Legal Assistance Program is a great place to go. get advice and assistance if things need to be escalated for legal assistance, like in the courts. The Housing Justice Project is an amazing project that is funded by the King County Bar Association. And they work with households who are needing direct service support in the court system. So those are the pathways that I would we will be talking with families and households about if they have indeed received eviction notices. They should be less common. I think what we're going to see is more likely is now that the bridge moratoria, the bridge proclamation and the moratoria have expired, we are very deeply concerned that we're going to be seeing a lot more evictions with people, and that they're going to be carrying very, very high balances.
Thanks so much, Miriam. This next one might be for you as well. What is the most pressing barrier your clients face in finding and maintaining long-term stable housing?
There's a number. It's really complex because each family has their own unique needs and own unique history that have led them to, you know, our doors or Chelsea, you know, Boys and Girls Club, you know, and so I think some of the top ones though are access. There's, you know, significant institutional and systemic racism that plays a huge part in people having access. There's intergenerational and generational trauma, there are cultural and language barriers that we see. Sometimes immigration, just because it's just a very lengthy process, that can be a major barrier. But those are some of like the main things we do see as those high barriers, as well as people who are coming to us who are carrying past evictions on their low credit and things like that. Those are definitely major barriers. And then of course we all know that it is very expensive to live here. It is extraordinarily expensive to live in this region. It's not just King County, right? We all know like this is like a major regional issue, and that there's not enough units for people who are just, for a lot of different reasons, again, those systemic reasons, are not able to boost their income or get out of a cycle of poverty and frankly trauma, and are not provided access to opportunities that some others are. So those are, it's convoluted, but there's a lot of complexity there, but I think I touched on all the key pieces.
Thanks so much, Miriam. Next question for Marty. Will Mary's Place reopen those 300 shelter beds soon that were lost due to COVID?
Great question. And you know, we are on it. We are working very hard to gain back those beds. We've been working different solutions throughout COVID. Some have worked out, some haven't, but we hope to have an exciting announcement here soon about the possibility of opening something new to gain back those beds. So stay tuned. That's what I'll say about that.
Thanks. And next question, AMI is high, but rents are also high. Alison, can you address what affordable rent is dollar-wise?
I can help try to clarify. It's county-based typically. So the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, HUD, which is the acronym many of you are probably familiar with, annually they set fair market rents for each area, essentially. So usually county-based. And then what happens from there is the public housing authority typically determines a payment standard. It's usually between 90% to 110% of the fair market rates for that particular area. So while they're high, the positive of that is that at least they're taking into account the data from specific areas when they're going to set those particular standards. And then from there, there are standards based on occupancy, household size, and other factors. So I won't give exact dollar amounts, but if you're interested in looking at that, you can Google HUD, H-U-D, fair market rents, and it'll give you a portal where you can enter in your zip code to learn more about what that looks like in your particular area too.
Great, thank you so much, Alison.
Sure.
Next question, Miriam, if you could help answer this, does immigration status impact your ability to get the federal funding?
No, which is amazing. So the direction and the criteria that we've seen, that's not even a question that's being asked. We're not required to ask it. There's nowhere that people have to provide documentation. So it is very low barrier, which has been incredibly valuable for all of the people we're serving. And I know Chelsea, you and your team, you can attest to like how significant that is, that that's not even something that people are having to worry about. I do think that people are still afraid of that, you know, of having to disclose immigration status. But that's something that we work really hard to like reassure households that we're not going to be asking that. We just want to know, you know, were you impacted by COVID, either directly or indirectly? Are you behind on rent? Those are like the main questions that we initially ask folks and to determine eligibility.
Thanks, Miriam. Next one, I can throw this to you, Dominique, if you could help a bit with this. Did enough federal money come to King County to pay the COVID-related back rents, and will it get spent in time to use it all up?
Thank you for the question. So what we know is there was about 50,000 families that were behind in rent that were reported, and the funding that we currently have is said to serve about half of those families. So as of right now, there is more need than there is dollars. There is projected to be some additional dollars distributed through King County in 2022. We do not know the full amount at this time, but what I would say is there has been a lot of great collaboration on how to distribute all these funds, being more flexible with the timeframe, because I think all of us have been really surprised at the amount of money that needs to go out of the door and the capacity that really, quite frankly, wasn't available right away. And so we do plan to spend all of the dollars that were distributed to us, as well as those that were in King County from other providers that were chosen to be providers. And then whatever comes our way, the same thing. We are working tirelessly to get our families what they need to stay in those hard-won homes.
Thank you, Dominique. And next question, possibly for Marty. What is the best way to contribute financially to rent relief? And is there a need for volunteers to help with eviction prevention?
Ooh, great questions. We love these questions. Yes, there's ways to help, right? Mary's Place really has a rapid response fund, which is dollars that goes directly to families. And especially as you're hearing, those families that are in the gaps, right, that aren't being served by the large landlord tenant program, that aren't winning the, essentially what I call winning the lottery for the tenant funds. So that is for me, that is one of the best places to give, because it will go directly back to those families that aren't getting other resources. And we want to make sure that we can prevent them from having to leave their homes as well. So you can give. We have a campaign going on now, our end of the year campaign, that's called the No Child Sleeps Outside campaign at nochildsleepsoutside.org. I'm sure our team will put that in the chat for you, and we'll share more about that. But really, our goal is to prevent 4,000 families members from leaving their homes. And so our goal is to raise $2 million to help do that. And we would love for you to be part of that campaign.
Volunteers are critically important in this, right? You know your neighbors, you see neighbors that are struggling, you may hear of others that are struggling. Sharing what you know now that there is help out there and how to connect with that help and support. Mary's Place has a portal on our website, and Miriam, I'll turn it over to Miriam after this and she can share more about how you can get folks connected that might need services, prevention services. We have a lot of other programs at Mary's Place where you can help and support families. Some of that is through our Make a Home program and really helping make their family. Many people are living even still, even though they have an apartment, doesn't mean they have beds, doesn't mean that they have the supplies that they need inside their cupboards, and they're having to spend money on diapers and all different types of things. And sometimes that doesn't go to rent. And so we can share with you different ways to do that through our volunteer program. But yes, we need you for all of these pieces. So, and we're happy to share more. But I do want to turn it over to Miriam. If there are folks in the community that need help with prevention resources, is that something you can share a little more about how they would go about applying for those?
Yeah, so one of the best ways to connect to the rental assistance is through our website. So it's through go to marysplaceseattle.org and to the Get Help page, and there's a rental assistance tab. And there's a pretty quick form that you can go ahead and fill out or send to someone to fill out. And there's a pathway for folks if they are non-native English speakers who will get a call back, so they don't have to go ahead and complete this whole form. And that is like the fastest way to get connected. And I think, Chelsea, you all have that similar pathway as well. Is that through your website again?
Yes, folks can go to positiveplace.org and the application actually just pops right up.
Awesome. I knew it was there. And I just want to echo what Marty said about the Make a Home program. It is it's a wonderful program that has even during COVID, it's amazing. We've been so lucky to receive both private and corporate donations for these critical pieces of furniture like beds and kitchen tables. So, kids have somewhere to sit and do their homework, and couches and these things that just make a home a home. And there are a lot of opportunities for volunteering through that program, both to just through donations, but also through other creative pathways. So definitely on our website, there's the volunteer tab. So if you want to help, there's tons of opportunities there as well.
Thank you so much. Oops, sorry, Marty. a couple more questions coming in here. Prevention is critical. My question is, how can we better serve in the community to act as an interventionist to point people towards these resources?
Who wants to jump in on that one? That's a really good question.
I can start if anyone wants to chime in. I think one of the ways of which we're trying to do this is really partnering with folks. So people that are on the call, if you're a community person and you're trying to figure out how do I help, I think, we had some suggestions, and that's a great way to just seek out some of those things. I also think we've started to really create these partnerships that are community-based, that like with Boys and Girls Club, with Alison and her team, really thinking about folks like that, and so that we can close these gaps. We know folks are disproportionately represented in all of these systems. And so when people are attached to particular families that are in their crisis, we're able to kind of say, hey, how can you support? This is what we can do. How can you support? Because everybody has a piece to the puzzle. That also means if you're volunteer hours, or if you're able to give it financially, all of those things really make that puzzle piece fit really well, so that we can really keep families in their homes and be a part of that solution of having no child sleep outside.
Thanks so much. Let's see here. Kind of a similar question, but I think maybe going a little bit more. As property managers, we have been working with tenants to help direct them to resources available through various rent relief organizations. Is there an outreach that management can provide to further help bridge the gap for those individuals that may have said barriers like language, technology, to help them connect with the appropriate resources?
I think I can jump in here from a property management standpoint. We have tried to access resources that have been developed typically at the county level and sometimes with partnerships specifically too. So for example, King County on their EPRAP website has, I believe, up to 10 major languages from our region where the information's been translated for those languages. And those can be downloaded as flyers and utilized to help facilitate for someone where English may be a second language. I know that working in some of the other counties specifically, that there have been hires made in the space of outreach. DCHS, I know, has had access to organizations where people speak multiple languages, where they can deploy people. So if you know specifically that someone has a language barrier and you're trying to access support, going through that partnership channel and letting them know that someone who's applying has a language barrier can help you access someone to come, you know, either on site or meet the individual to be able to facilitate in their language specifically too.
Thank you. Let's see here, a couple more questions. Regarding the government funding, how much has been distributed? What percentage of families have been assisted?
Miriam, do you want to take that? I have a little bit of information, but I don't have the full totality here in those weekly meetings.
Yeah. So going off of just my most recent information, I know King County is working on creating a dashboard for everyone in the community to be able to go and reference the spend down. But the last information I have is around 85 million. So that number has increased in the last week. Has gone out the door. And that's a significant chunk. It's, if I'm going off of, again, my most recent information, looks like there's about 28,000 households who've actively been or being served right now, which is a great number, but we're not gonna make it all the way. And then there's just to plug again, there is a major concern around, I think, the entire social service community of what's going to happen to households who may have received assistance, but who are not caught up yet. Like they are not fully stable, so they're not able to continue to pay their rent. So what's going to happen after that 3 months of future rent expires? So there's a lot of, pretty precarious, but that's our understanding of where the county is at as a whole throughout the three programs, the three pathways I referenced. So the landlord, the hub and spoke, and then the tenant pool.
And I'll add that there was $123 million for this period of funding that was distributed in King County, just for an idea of how much has been distributed.
Thanks, Dominique.
Great, thank you both so much. So I think that is all the questions that came in. If I missed yours though, please, if you wanna just send it in the Q&A, we can answer. You could also just raise your hand and I can let you speak if you just wanna ask your question directly. All right, and I just want to share too that after this, I will send out an email to everyone with some of the links that were referenced today and some other resources and information for you.
I think somebody asked about the volunteer or the Make a Home program, and that's through Mary's Place as well. So you can just, we'll share the volunteer link, and that's how you can get connected to Make a Home too. And that is really just collecting items, maybe getting together with a group, and we'll connect you with a household that has just recently moved in or needs some help and support. So that's pretty exciting way to really meet your neighbors and make sure they have what they need to feel, to make their house feel like a home, right? And they're much more likely to stay in their homes if it feels like a home. And so I guess we've already shared that link in chat. So sorry about that, but thank you for your interest in that program. Awesome. Well, I just wanna say thank you for this amazing group, for all of you for taking your time today to learn about what's happening in our community, how you can help and support your neighbors, how we can really work realistically to achieve No Child Sleeps Outside in our community. You are the champions and the advocates we need right here in our hometown. There are lots of ways that you can continue to give and make a difference. Support our No Child Sleeps Outside campaign that we already shared about. That's going on through December 31st. And you can see how we're tracking to our $2 million goal on the nochildsleepsoutside.org website. And some other ways to give this holiday season is the gift of time. We know that it's precious. We know that it's hard to find the time, but the holidays are right around the corner, and we'll be hosting Holly Jolly parties at our shelters, where families will celebrate together by picking out gifts for each other, eating delicious food, visiting with Santa or Olaf the snowman, and who will be dancing and more. There's so much more joy to experience. All these days are not merry and bright for everyone, right? And being in shelter is traumatic, and it's oftentimes a reminder of what you've lost around the holidays. So bringing those fun events and participating and volunteering at those makes a big difference. So you can check out our website for those and other volunteer opportunities. And of course, we'll be doing more Lunch and Learn events like these, where we'll share about other aspects of the work we do together with our partners to address and prevent family homelessness. And we hope to see you at those as well. And then just a note that following today's event, you'll get that follow-up email that Katrina talked about with a link to the recording that we had today. You can share that with anyone that you would like, as well as other information about the opportunities that we've shared. And last but not least, you'll see a little pop-up in your browser right after you exit this. It's a survey. We hope you'll just take a couple minutes to let us know what you thought about this discussion. Was it helpful? Was it not helpful? How we could make it better or different for you? And most importantly, are there other topics that you want us to address? Things you've been wondering about in the homeless community? We want to be able to address those and respond to your needs as well. Most importantly, thank you for being you. Thank you for caring and loving your neighbors so well. Thank you for wanting to learn more. And thank you to our panelists. You are amazing. And the teams that you lead are on the front lines every day doing this hard work day in and day out. And we are so grateful and thankful for the sacrifices that they are making. So we appreciate each of you. May you enjoy your holidays. Thank you for making ours a little bit brighter today. And take care and have a wonderful afternoon. Thank you, everyone.